The stones are not as large as Stonehenge, or as grand as Chichen Itza. Yet this humble spot of rocks and stones is located in one of the most profound locations on Earth. There are 10 places in the world called nuclei of continents. These are widely separated places of relatively small patches of ancient rocks that first cooled the molten Earth's crust into a single huge island called Gondwanaland. Around 300 million years ago, Gondwanaland separated, drifting on continental plates of ancient rock bed into our present continent somewhere between 65 million and about 1 million years ago. Bighorn Medicine Mountain is one of these rare ancient continental routes. The cutaway profile shows layers of rock color-coded by age, the youngest lying in the valleys where the Bighorn and Powder Rivers run, and the oldest peaking against the sky. It is as though the great crow chief god of creation, Coyote, ripped open the earth and pulled the earth's core up into the heavens. In only this part of the world can you clearly see all of the Earth's layers. To the Native American, this is indeed sacred ground. The Bighorn Medicine Wheel is similar in layout to England's Stonehenge. Sometimes the Bighorn Medicine Wheel is called Woodhenge because different ground depressions were the site of large wooden posts. With a diameter of 87 feet, the rim is almost exactly the same size as a Sarsen's circle, the principal feature at Stonehenge. There are 5 more cairns spaced along the wheel rim, each of which marks the end of a spoke. One spoke extends some distance beyond the rim of the wheel, where it terminates at a 7th cairn. It was this extended spoke that first called attention to Bighorn's astronomical significance. This spoke is aligned with the direction that the sun rises on the summer solstice. Once this was established, it was possible to sort out the alignments of the other spokes that end at cairns. One is aligned with the direction that the sun sets on the summer solstice, while the other 4 point to the rising points of the bright stars holding special significance to natives: Aldebaran, Rigel, Sirius, and Formalhut. The medicine wheel looks down from the precipices of the most ancient times to slopes that get progressively more modern until in the valleys on either side are sedimentary rocks deposited in merely the last million to few hundred thousand years. Thus, medicine wheel floats on a high island of time, the world's oldest rocks, layered in reverse order of the epochs of geological history. Everyone has heard of Machu Picchu, 9,000 feet above sea level, a place only accessible by foot, a mighty structure built out of quarried stone so accurate that not even a knife blade can slide within the recesses of the stone. But there is another ancient observatory in Peru that better qualifies as an ancient analog computer and observatory. The 2,300-year-old solar observatory at Chanquillo, Peru, is the earliest such structure identified. And unlike all other sites, Chanquillo contains alignments that cover the entire solar year. Inca practices of astronomy were very sophisticated, and they used buildings as a form of landscape timekeeping to mark the positions of the sun on key dates of the year. Chanquillo was better known in the past for a heavily fortified hilltop structure with massive walls, restricted gates, and parapets. But for many years, the purpose of a 300-meter-long line of 13 towers lying along a small hill had remained a mystery. The new evidence now identifies it as a solar observatory. When viewed from 2 specially constructed observing points, the 13 towers are strikingly visible on the horizon, resembling large prehistoric teeth. Around the observing points are spaces where artifacts indicate that ritual gatherings were held. Chincheo is remarkable as the earliest known complete solar observatory in the Americas that defines all the major aspects of the solar year. The 13 towers of Chincheo are seen by two unique and indisputable observation points, spanning the entire season of solar rising and setting arcs, providing the clearest possible indication that they were built specifically to facilitate sunrise and sunset observations throughout the seasonal year, making Chincheo number 2 on our list. Coming in at number 3 is an ancient land of blood, warriors, and passionate dedication to the sun. Human sacrifice was known to be the path to divine blessings. These sacrifices were considered necessary in order to ensure good weather, bountiful crops, and prosperity to their land. The life of the Maya revolved around the concept of time. Priests were consulted on civil, agricultural, and religious matters, and their advice would be derived from the readings of the sacred calendars. Time was of such importance that children were even named after the date on which they were born. In the Yucatan Peninsula, there are two structures which celebrate Mayan solar calendars and observations. One is a round structure called the caracol or snail because of its winding staircase. It is the only round Mayan building ever encountered. The tower has many windows for observing the equinoxes and summer solstice. This tower gives excellent, unobstructed views of the skies and surrounding landscape. In particular, it seems to be carefully aligned with the motions of Venus. Venus had tremendous significance for the Maya community. This bright planet was considered a war god and the sun's twin. Mayan leaders used the changing position of Venus to plan appropriate times for battles and raids. The other sun structure at Chichen Itza is the Great Pyramid. The Maya situated the pyramid very carefully so that on the equinox on March 20th and 21st, the north side appears wholly in shadow, while the west side is bathed completely in light. The pyramid has 365 steps, one for each day of the year. During the spring and fall equinoxes, that is when the day and the night are of equal length, the Great Pyramid serves as a visual symbol of the day and night. On every equinox, the sun of the late afternoon creates the illusion of a snake creeping slowly down the northern staircase. As the sun begins to fall, the triangles on the staircase are lit in such a way that they seem to move down the side of the staircase from the sky to the ground. This solar equinox spectacle represents the Maya calendar and the cosmos executed in stone. This engineering feat was accomplished with stone tools, without the wheel, and by orienting the corners with celestial points. The pyramid sits figuratively and metaphorically at the center of time and space, a temple, the cosmos, a calendar, a sundial, and a giant computer. The Mayans created the most accurate solar and lunar calendar ever made. Not even modern man has improved on this calendar. For this, the ancient observatories of Mexico ranks third on our list. Sunlit entrances still record the passage of the seasons in locations throughout the American Southwest. People throughout history and throughout the world have sought the synchronization and integration of the solar and lunar cycles. In the American Southwest are the remains of an elaborate culture, the Anasazi. Long ago, these people recorded the movement of the sun on rock formations and in rock dwellings. Their etchings are called petroglyphs. One significant petroglyph is above Chaco Canyon near the top of an outcropping known as Fajita Butte. On a wall are two spiral petroglyphs, one large and one small. Sunlight passes over them at various times throughout the year. On the summer solstice, a single sliver of sunlight, a sun dagger, appears near the top of the larger spiral and over a period of 18 minutes, slices its way down through the very center, cutting the spiral in half before leaving it in shadow once again. On the winter solstice, two daggers of light appears for 49 minutes, during which time they exactly frame the larger spiral. Finally, an equally fascinating and more complex light show occurs on the spring and fall equinoxes. On each equinox, a dagger of light appears that cuts through the larger spiral, not through its center, but exactly between the fourth and fifth grooves from the center. In other words, it cuts exactly halfway between the center and the outer edge of the spiral, just as the equinoxes cut the time between the solstices exactly in half. A more spectacular display of a petroglyph is the view of the sun dagger at Hovenweet National Monument. Two concentric circle spirals are illuminated as the sun rises on the summer solstice. Within a matter of minutes, two separate shafts of light, the first appearing from the left and the second from the right, make contact in the center, forming one large band of light. Another unique petroglyph is this one. It records the sudden appearance in the skies of a supernova, or an exploding dying star, in 1054 AD. The supernova glowed as brightly as the full moon. It dominated the skies during the night and day. For the people of Chaco, the supernova would have flamed above their canyon next to a crescent moon. The Chacoan people recorded this event. The images in the Chaco pictograph, sealed against the centuries by the dry desert air, are still vivid. The artist seems intimately present. Chaco Canyon contains the most sweeping collection of ancient ruins north of Mexico. Some structures are thought to serve as astronomical observatories or calendars. The canyon itself runs along one of the lunar alignment lines, suggesting the location was originally chosen for its astronomical significance. Many Chacoan buildings were aligned to capture the solar and lunar cycles, requiring generations of astronomical observations and centuries of skillfully coordinated construction. At Chaco, there is a great circular structure named Casa Rinconada, half sunk into the earth on a hill. This kiva is a ceremonial place in Chacoan culture, as well as a symbol of the cosmos. Aligned with the cardinal directions, the line connecting the north and south doors to Casa Rinconada is within 1/3 of a degree of true north. A compelling alignment exists within Casa Rinconada. At sunrise on the summer solstice, a beam of light from a northeastern opening in the kiva precisely illuminates a uniquely placed niche in the far wall. Another Chacoan culture building lies further north at Hovenweet Castle. The building is aligned so that the light is channeled through slots into the building at sunset of the summer solstice, the winter solstice, and the spring and fall equinox. The light falls in a predictable pattern on interior door lintels. The solar and lunar cosmology encoded in the massive architecture at Chaco Canyon or at Hovenweet, the building's orientations, internal geometry, and geographic relationships unify the Chacoan people with each other and with the cosmos. This order in the cosmos is recorded in vast stretches across the sky, the desert, and time. It is as though to be held in the mind's eye, one thinking eye that sees into and beyond natural phenomena to a sacred order. The Chacoans transformed an empty space into a reach of the mind. For this, the Chaco culture is our choice for number 4. Throughout history and prehistory, human lives have been guided by our sun. Today, we can analyze the intensity of a solar storm. We can understand the life cycle of a sun. And we can witness planets orbiting a sun outside our own solar system. But our distant ancestors, who saw the sun as life, were just as knowledgeable as us of the life-giving cycles of the sun. If that is so, could ancient people have performed sophisticated observations of our sun worthy of today's analog computers? Join us as we look into the five top ancient observatories. To begin our list, we selected a site that was home to ancient mythologies until researchers confirmed that this location of monolithic stones was actually an observatory. Long after it was built, some 4,000 or 5,000 years ago, the purpose for the building of Stonehenge was lost. Over the years, Stonehenge became a ground of worship for the ancient Druids. Legends purport that this was the site of King Arthur's crowning. Surely the site had a monumental purpose. What could have been so important that people would haul 900 stones, some weighing 50 tons, from a quarry site 240 miles away? What need would cause primitive people to lift such stones 13 feet into place? The answer is the sun. In 1963, astronomer Gerald Hawkins looked at the stones a different way. Using a computer, which was rare in 1963, he noticed numerous solar and lunar alignments. Stonehenge was not built for Druid rituals or the crowning of kings. Stonehenge was an observatory. Determining the winter solstice helped ancient people know when the sun would begin its cycle from the short days of winter to the longer days of spring and summer. Spring meant warmer weather and planting time for this cold, misty land. It seems these ancient, unsophisticated primitives were not so primitive after all. They built a huge observatory based on their own kind of scientific observations and, in their own way, created an analog calendar. Hawkins' research gave rise to the term archaeoastronomy, a new science studying how cultures understood phenomena in the sky and how that phenomenon was observed. All research and discoveries of additional ancient sites that witness a solar event owed its success to the groundbreaking research astronomer Gerald Hawkins did in 1963. So that is why Stonehenge begins our list of ancient observatories.
Are you getting a TV picture now, Houston?
Neil, yes, we are getting a TV picture. You're in our field with you now.
That's one small step for man, one giant leap for